Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.
You may have heard about Denver's Metro Gang Task Force, but what does a task force really do? Former Commander Jim Welton and Investigator Bob Fuller joined Denver DA Mitch Morrissey to talk about the Metro Gang Task Force on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Hello, everyone. I'm Tamara Banks, and welcome to Dialogue Denver DA. Mitch, nice to be with you again today.
Nice to be with you, Tamara.
You have some, we have some guests, a couple guys you've worked with pretty intensely.
Yeah, there are guys that have just had a career in law enforcement, both of them, and just make a huge difference in our community over the years. We have Commander Jim Welton. He's retired from the Aurora Police Department. He's worked for the Department of Corrections. He's had an outstanding career. And then Robert Fuller, I was lucky enough to hire when I became the Denver DA about 10 years ago. I got him away from the Arapahoe County Sheriffs. Bob is one of the nationally known individuals when it comes to gang, the way gangs operate, who's in the gang, what's the gang, and I think probably the most famous case, we had a gang, Hmong gang in Boulder, that kidnapped and raped a girl. And I think Bob turned on the news and saw the van that they used and knew who it was, called the Boulder police, and within a short period of time, that case was completely solved, rounded up everybody except one individual who killed himself or got killed in Milwaukee or Green Bay, Wisconsin, mm-hmm, after having fled. So these two people, like I say, I'm just honored to have them on the show because of what they've done in their careers.
And let's talk about that. Let's talk a little bit about what the gang, Metro Gang Task Force, actually does. And it started in, was it the mid-90s?
Yeah, the Metro Gangs Task Force began in 1993, mm-hmm, in this, what was known at that time in the Denver community as the Summer of Violence.
That's right.
I think there was some history before that, though. Law enforcement as a whole saw the change in gang behavior beginning, at least in my experience, in the beginning of the 80s. And in the late 80s, there was a change in the drug scene. And part of that was, a big part of that was, the evolution of crack cocaine. And once crack cocaine became an accepted drug on the streets, you saw a tremendous change in the behavior in some of the communities. And prior to that, we had small gangs. We had gangs that were not as hardcore. And crack cocaine drove the stakes up. It became much more lucrative to buy powder cocaine, convert it to crack cocaine, begin selling it. And the competition for turf and markets and the dollars associated with that, combined with a culture of violence associated with gang activity, drove behaviors in our communities. And in 1993, if some of the audience remembers that, Governor Romer called a special session of the legislature. We had kids being shot by strangers over things like what jacket they wore or other, mm-hmm, things. There were, I believe, 36 or 37 teenagers killed on the streets. I remember, for me, it was pretty special because there were two children shot, one of them sitting in his car seat. Yeah. Another one, a one-year-old boy, shot at the seal exhibit at our Denver Zoo. I think every law enforcement officer, every prosecutor, everyone in the criminal justice system knew we had to respond. So putting together Metro Gang was a logical response. It was a collaborative effort of federal, state, and local. And grants were received. And we took that project from when crack was being enforced by the crack task force, and Commander Gary Graham was from the Denver Police Department, ran that very successfully. We transferred that to the Aurora Police Department, and we hosted a multi-jurisdictional approach, which involved Denver and Aurora and the FBI as the three first agencies at the table to make a difference for Denver.
I remember that time, and I know everybody was just scratching their head going, what can we do to address this? Investigator, talk a little bit about some of the groups that are involved with the task force.
Well, we have our main partners, the Aurora Police Department, which is the main sponsor, has a commander and a sergeant. And then we have Denver Police Department, we have the FBI, which is a good partner, and then we have Douglas County, Adams County, Denver District Attorney's Office, Rapo County, State Patrol, Homeland Security, just a lot of agencies for the whole metro area
right.
to attack the problem.
Can you talk about why it's important to bring all those agencies together and work as one rather than just in their own silos in their own communities?
Because we share resources. We have all these resources. It's a joint effort between the U.S. Attorney's Office and all the local district attorney offices where we could file cases on complex investigations. And it's a shared resource. We get things done that Denver District Attorney's Office couldn't do by itself, or Adams County Sheriff's Department couldn't do by itself, but collaboratively we do it together.
You know, and it's drastic when, it's interesting, when they successfully indict 70, 80, 90 gang members, oftentimes for like what Jim was saying, drug activity and gang activity and guns. And, you know, when they do a major takedown, they'll find lots of money, lots of drugs, and lots of guns. And these guys are surviving on selling drugs and selling guns and then hurting people in our community. And you'll see just kind of, it's a vacuum. They're gone. They're in federal custody, they're in state custody. And sometimes you gotta be careful, because I have seen successful sweeps where then the guys that are left on the street are actually the guys that are under the control of the people that we got, and you end up with more violence. Aurora saw that when they were very successful. We were successful at taking out a gang. They were referred to as the Horton Gang. We took off the top guys. Well, the top guys actually were keeping the more violent guys kind of quiet. And then, boom, Aurora blew up with these guys just going all over. And again, we go out together because we had the history, because it was a Denver gang. We're able to then build cases and show that they are an organization for the purpose of committing crimes. And that is the critical part of this task force, is they are take down entire criminal organizations at the federal level with the U.S. Attorney's Office, or at our level with the same kind of statute that shows that, okay, maybe this one person doesn't look like they really are involved that much, but they are part of this criminal enterprise. And this punishment, when we get those kinds of convictions, they're very serious felonies that carry an awful lot of time. So when you're talking about white supremacist gangs, when you're talking about Crips and the Bloods, Hispanic gangs, it doesn't matter. The task force is a huge help in that area.
And I remember just a short time before, I think I started covering news in 1993 in Denver, and there was a time when, say, Aurora would say, have a crackdown, and particularly just take the Colfax corridor. And so they would have a crackdown, and then everybody, all the gangsters would shuffle on down to west to Denver. And then you'd have this back and forth. And I imagine that being able to work together with these agencies, you don't have, you know, people running from one community to another.
When we did one of the takedowns on the Roland 30s, it was the largest takedown in the state. We had over 500 officers involved.
I think about 450 officers participated.
And every jurisdiction in the Denver metro area that we, in the suburbs, in the inner city, it didn't matter. We were hitting all those locations.
The same day. Within a day or so. So when people are trying to move, that kind of thing, you know, there's a lot of safety issues, that kind of thing. But when they hit hard and fast and try to get as many people into custody as possible.
Simultaneously.
So can you kind of walk us through what that looks like if you're working on a particular operation?
Well, we do these complex cases, so our cases sometimes take a year to 2 years to come to fruition through our investigative methods. And then the commander here, it would be his responsibility and the sergeant's to orchestrate this takedown. Mm-hmm. I'll let you talk about that.
When you talked about pushing criminals back and forth across boundaries, you know, most law enforcement agencies are designed to serve their community within the boundaries of their community. And they protect, do a great job doing that. A task force approach pursues violent criminals, career criminals, wherever they are. And so with the understanding that when they're arrested in Denver, that benefits Aurora. When they're arrested in Lakewood, that benefits Adams County, that there's a shared benefit when career criminals are taken off the street. When we did a large case, there was a lot of coordination because it's important with that much law enforcement going on simultaneously that, you know, that responsible supervision is associated with that so that the right people are arrested, the right search warrants are served, and that, you know, because that does involve a lot of moving parts.
Right. I'm really curious to find out, how difficult was it to get the agencies to come to the table? I mean, was there some sort of territory pushback? This is our turf, this is what we do, and I'm curious to hear how the maybe some egos were ironed out in order to able to serve the people.
I could say that among the investigators and the group of people we work with, we all work together. So if we're working on a current case, everybody works together on that case, and it's not a turf issue. Every agency once has a problem with a specific gang or organization, and they want us to attack it. So they come to the table and say, hey, can you help us with this? And then we'll take on that challenge. So, and sometimes we can't move on it at that time, but later on we can. So, and the leaders, there's a board meeting every month. So Mitch, the head of the FBI, Adams County Sheriff, Arapahoe County Sheriff, all their people, Denver, all sit down and discuss what is going on. And we, as case agents, give presentation to the board members to let them know the status of our ongoing investigations.
Really, when I started being involved in this, you know, the benefit that I saw was that we were, when I took over in the SDA, we had a group that was murdering people at a very high rate. They were a gang, they were drug, so they were making $1 million probably a month. And so they were serious. They had very violent individuals. Not only would they hit people, but they would gang style murder people, but they would also occasionally shoot a professional athlete that they ran across in a bar. So we, you know, and everybody knows in 07 when Darrent Williams was killed, the cornerback, gonna be a star in the NFL. He's gunned down in his limousine. Well, that was the gang. What did I know about that? One, I knew they were good for 12 or more murders. And there were mothers out there that had lost their sons, and they maybe didn't get the attention because they weren't kids that played for the Broncos. But I knew this group was responsible for that. And I also knew that we weren't solving any of those cases. And Denver Homicide was working extremely hard to try to get those. And they take great pride in solving and clearing cases. And I turned to the task force. And I knew that they were looking at a particular gang that these guys were an offshoot of. I knew they were gonna do a takedown in a certain amount of time. I begged them for a month. I found the resources to get Bob out there and promised them that Bob would work on these 9 guys that we knew had information that would then lead to possibly solving some of those 12 cases, including the Darrent Williams case, including the murder of a witness of ours, Kalani Ann Clark, in another case. And that's the value of it to the locals, is that one, you take 70 guys off the street, these are 70 criminals, they're hardcore, but they're also doing things like killing people in your community. And you can then start to solve
those murders, the secondary kind of cases, because the people that are now in trouble are looking at lengthy sentences in the federal penitentiary. And people always say, oh, look at how many people we have in federal custody, and they're there for drugs, and you know, that's a big thing that always try to, they're there for large amounts of drugs that are poisoning and killing people in our community. The feds don't put you in prison for a half a gram of cocaine. We don't do that in the state. So these guys were major dealers who were gang members that would kill you as soon as look at you. And they were looking at life sentences, they were looking at lengthy sentences, and they started telling us the truth about those murders. They started saying, I was in that car when Willie Clark shot and killed Darren Williams. And that's how we solved those cases. And without that task force, we never would have solved those cases. I firmly believe to this day, we would still have those guys out on the street. They would still be killing people. They would still be making millions of dollars with drugs and guns, and we wouldn't have solved the case. Now, there was some pushback there because Denver Homicide wanted to solve that case really badly. And so there was some turf and there was some things that went on. But the bottom line is, when once we all got on the same page and we started moving towards solving that, I got to hand it to Chief Whitman and the people in the Denver Police Department. To a degree, they kind of swallowed their egos to a bit, got the information we needed, and it took us 3 years to hold those people accountable. But if it wasn't for Jim Welton, Bob Fuller, and that task force, I believe those people would still be on our streets today and still be hurting people.
And I'm sure there are many stories that are just like that with great success innings. We're going to take a break and come back. We're talking here on Dialogue Denver DA about the Metro Gang Task Force. We'll be right back. Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks, and this is the portion of the show where we talk about a legal term. Today's legal term is prosecutorial discretion. And what that means, it refers to a prosecutor's power on such matters as whether or not to bring criminal charges, the nature of charges, guilty plea agreements, and sentence recommendation. What does that all mean, Mitch?
Well, you know, we do have a lot of discretion. Mm-hmm. I think one of the cases that I remember, when Bill Ritter was the DA, we had a family who had a Rottweiler who had bitten a child once and then later actually killed their little boy. And he could have charged the family. He could have charged the parents, and he chose not to. He said, you know, what good would that do? I mean, he used his discretion, and technically they violated the law, but he thought, you know, that would be something that they had lost their child, so he used his discretion and didn't bring those charges. But we have discretion when it comes to adding charges, habitual criminal charges, for instance. We don't always bring those, but we can. We have the discretion to bring those or not bring those, depending on the circumstances. We have a lot in charging. We have a lot in when we plea bargain a case. You know, we bring things down to what we think are fair sometimes, what we think a fair sentence could be. We sometimes give somebody a range. We lower the sentencing range with a cap, that type of thing. All of those things are within our discretion. And you know, I really leave that to my prosecutors. I try to hire people that are reasonable, that are fair, that know their cases, work hard on their cases, and do the right thing in court. And a lot of that is our discretion. And I think that to a degree why the Denver DA's office is respected as well as it is across the state is because we exercise that discretion well. Mm-hmm. We're good at it.
And looking at people as humans, and each
sometimes,
case is different.
Or yeah. Really bad humans.
Right.
It just depends.
Exactly.
It depends.
Okay, well, let's get back to talking about the Metro Gang Task Force. And just before the break, I was about to ask you, how can you quantify the success or impact that the Metro Gang Task Force has? Is there a way to measure that, Commander?
Well, it's always tough to measure what doesn't happen when violent criminals are arrested and they're put into custody. They're not committing new crimes in the community, and it's hard to measure what didn't happen. But we're at the Metro Gang Task Force. We looked at a couple of different cases in order to try to capture that number some way. And, you know, during the time when we were doing those large cases involving the gang groups affiliated with the Darren Williams homicide, we knew that many of those individuals were involved with criminal behavior every single day. And so using informant information and depositions and information that we developed as part of that prosecution effort, I developed a profile, and most of the primary full-time gang members easily could state that they committed 8 to 10 felonies every single day.
Wow.
And that involved drug trafficking, gun trafficking, felon with a gun, sometimes robberies and menacing to get drug money, threatening other gang members, shooting at other gang members. We knew that they committed many offenses that affect our community. So even if you take that number and cut it in half and presume that they committed 5 felonies a day, and the task force often indicts smaller groups of, say, 25 gang members, if they're committing that many felonies every single day in a year, you have over 45,000 crimes that don't happen. It seems phenomenal. Mm-hmm. Now, understand that a lot of those crimes aren't reported. They're drug trafficking and done between gangs and things. But we know we have to make an impact because they do engage in violent behaviors. And, you know, we used to have kind of a funny saying at the task forces, we don't know who's home eating dinner tonight because of the work that's been done by all these agencies, the prosecutors and law enforcement. We don't know who's at home and not hurt by gang violence, but we know somebody is.
You know, I have to correct something, though. I said that Bob spent his career in Arapahoe County, and he probably cringed because he was an Adams County sheriff responsible for gang crimes in Adams County. Mm-hmm. You know, when you get out in those parts of out of Denver, you know, I get confused sometimes. So I apologize to Bob and anybody that's watching, because Bob's career before he came to the Denver DA's office was in Adams County.
Great. Duly noted.
Doug Dar would appreciate that.
Yeah. And the model that we've been talking about in this program is, it's a national model, right? Is the rest of the country sort of looking to you all as a model?
Metro Gang is the longest running successful task force across the nation, I believe, still to this day. Hmm. And also, because of the successes we've had here, other under the Safe Streets, the FBI Safe Streets umbrella, they have opened up Metro Gang Task Force similar in major cities across the country.
What do you think makes it so successful? Why is the whole country looking to you as a sort of the leader of the pack?
I think it's because of the teamwork between department heads, the commanders, the investigators, and they put their egos aside and go forward.
You know, they confiscate a lot of money too. And there is money there. And I can tell you what Bob's talking about. An email will go out and say, we need to improve this. Will people okay? Will the board okay the expenditure of these dollars for this purpose? And I can't remember a single time in 10 years where anyone voted no. Because the idea is that we take this money away from criminals. We have this money to improve this task force, and we're lucky because the taxpayers don't have to pay. You know, Denver contributes officers, Aurora contributes officers, we contribute Bob from the Denver DA's office. Different groups contribute more and more, so obviously taxpayers paying salaries, that kind of thing. But when we had to improve wires, wiretapping, those types of things, it's unanimous. People are like, spend that money, do this job, get that equipment. If that'll improve the work you guys are doing, I'm all for it.
And I will look at those emails and I will say, in 10 years, I don't remember. Now, Jim might remember somebody voting no, but I don't remember. I've never voted no. I'm a small player in this thing, but anything I can do to help support the work of this task force, I've gone out of my way to try to help that, because I know what benefit, beyond what Jim's talked about, we get out of it. You know, when we didn't have the resources to put Bob in the task force and we were confronted with all those murders, we went out and started raising private dollars. You know, Steve Farber from the law firm said, let's do some fundraising, Mitch. If the city won't step up, let's get somebody assigned. We need to solve these cases. People from the public were telling us that. So we raised about $50,000 at a couple of fundraisers, and the city heard what we were doing, and we had made a request and been turned down, but city council stepped up and said, listen, put him out there. We will okay it. We gave them the time frame of what we thought would happen. And I don't think, with maybe a couple of continuances of the first degree murder trial, I don't think we were off by more than a couple of months in what we told them it would take. And it took 3 years. But we held people accountable for very serious crimes. And all the people along the way got held accountable too. Everybody we put on the witness stand, almost 100%, were doing time somewhere for some crime that this task force held them accountable for.
I was just going to add, the Department of Justice has a couple of different publications, and one of the Metro Gang authorities contributed to those. But one of the most important things to success of a task force is leadership. And leadership is probably the most valued attribute. And when I look at Mitch being modest here, because he's been a leader in supporting the efforts of the task force. The leaders in the police departments and the sheriff's departments, the United States Attorney's Office, we've had a tremendous run in this community of leaders in our law enforcement community, and that's why this has been successful. The commitment of those leaders to a can-do attitude, they will work together. When there's bumps in the road, we'll figure out a way to work it out, because the community's will all benefit at the end of the day.
Gentlemen, thanks so much for being with us today on this edition of Dialogue DDDA. Thank you to retired Commander Jim Welton and Investigator Bob Fuller for joining us today on this edition of Dialogue DDDA. I'm Tamara Banks. We'll see you next time.
Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.